Ivey.
Here.
Ms. Ellis.
Here.
Mr. Worthy.
Here.
Ms. Williams.
Here.
Mr. Knox.
Here.
Ms. Thornton.
Here.
Thank you. Stand. We're going to a moment of silent meditation. We will follow that with the pledge of allegiance. Thank you.
Our congratulations to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic of which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dr. Lee, do you have any amendments to the agenda?
No, sir.
Now, any amendments, I'll obtain a motion for adopting the agenda. Moved by Ms. Ellis, seconded by Ms. Williams. All in favor? Ms. Thornton?
I'm sorry.
Thank you. Motion passed. All right. Recognition of visitors. We do have one visitor this evening. Mr. Spade, Mr. Sean Pollard here. Mr. Sean Pollard?
No, I'm going to move on.
Okay. We're down to Superintendent's report here. Dr. Means?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Worthy, board members. Just want to share with the board and our community that, share with the board and the community that we've had an outstanding start to the school year. As you all know, we started school yesterday. We had a chance to get out to most of our schools, and I've commented to all of our principals and staff members that it's amazing to me how efficient the schools have been. It doesn't feel like this first or second day of school. Our teachers are at it, they're teaching. The schools are working out very well. Kids are being picked up and dropped off safely. So I just wanted to take this time to say thank you to our hardworking teaching staff and support staff. And things are working well in Clark County. I shared this at the work session last week, but I want to share it again for this meeting. Our school year theme is Forward Together, that we are looking to move forward together as a school system. And part of that Forward Together is to look at all the components of our organization. And so as I continue to dig into my entry plan, we'll continue to look at all of our components of the organization to see how efficient we are and how we can continue to be an even better school system for the children of Clark County. The last thing I will share with you is that we're pleased to report that our student enrollment's up. Now, obviously, I like to say that we can't really count the student enrollment until we see the white in the student's eyes, until we see students sitting in seats. But preliminary information shows us that we are up at least 200 students from last school year. It's preliminary numbers, of course. Once we can solidify those numbers, we'll share it with not only the board, but the community. But I think the increase in student enrollment is just another sign that people are excited about what the teachers and staff are doing in Clark County and what the promise holds for this fine school system. Board members, Mr. Worthy, that's the conclusion of my report.
Thank you very much, Dr. B. We're down to item D, and that's board reports.
I can definitely do it. So our first report is our GSBA report.
I'm happy to report that we had our finest work session in Atlanta this year, and the reason for that is the fact that we decided to use NSBA first day to do all of the workshops, and it was wonderful. All the reports that I got from my 15 school system, that it was outstanding. They received first-rate training, and we're very happy at GSBA to realize that we've gone the last mile. produce the very best for our board members and superintendent throughout the state of Georgia.
Thank you.
Ms. Gordon, you have?
Yes, I'm going to work.
I'll stay. Okay. I'm reporting from the GSBA summer conference, which was way back in June. So I had to really kind of pull my notes together, but I actually sent all the board members, I just sent a more detailed, report in writing, so I would not spend much time on this. But one of the things I think that is being talked about across the nation is about diversity and equity. And the first day, that Thursday, or that Wednesday, you know, that was orientation for new board members. But on Thursday, one of the workshops was led by Glenn Singleton, and it's in your email. And he really dove deep about diversity and equity. And he gave some startling data on the demographics from Atlanta. And it generated a lot of conversation because in the data he showed that African-American kids who were from middle to upper class income families did not do well as their white counterpart. He also showed data that African-American kids who were on free and reduced lunch did not do as well as their white counterparts on free and reduced lunch. So that generated a lot of buzz and uncomfortableness, I think. And he said the common denominator is race, and that we have to, if we're really talking about helping kids, we need to have a courageous, I think the top of his title was a courageous conversation about equity. And the data, I did not get the forms. He actually did like little workshops. It was more interactive than just a presentation. And some of the topics were white privilege, race in my life, hands up, don't shoot. And those are very controversial subjects, but he said, don't get mad at the data. He didn't bring it. It was like, this was your data. So that was different. I actually brought one of his books, More Courageous Conversations About Race. So I don't know what we do with that part of the report, but that was one of the interesting things. Our GSBA director, Valerie Wilson, stated over 60% of people in poverty are people of color. And on Friday morning, Mr. Payne had his inspirational service again. That is growing larger and larger. People are coming and waking up at 7 o'clock in the morning and getting inspired. And I think that it's becoming a tradition. And then they had Miranda Beer. She's the past president of MSBA. And she talked about almost the same things. I don't know whether this was supposed to be centered around equity, but she stated that budgets that adequately funds public education should not be a cookie cutter. If policies don't work, they need to be changed if it's not in the best interest of kids. And then Alberto Cavallato also talked about what they're doing in Miami schools as far as equity is concerned. So that's basically it. I see that my font type has kind of jumped, but when you can read it in more detail, and if there's anything I can answer, I'll be glad to. But it was a good conference. We did have our delegate assembly, and we voted on the items that each of you had been presenting.
So, Vina, can I ask you a question?
Yes.
So, yeah, and I'm looking forward to your report, but then was there, you know, I mean, this is, some of this stuff is not shocking, some of it, having put it into the
the realm of discussion. What was their brainstorming as to how to address it? Or are people just kind of letting it sink in?
One of the things he suggested is that school districts looking at hiring an equity coordinator that could look at those kind of issues. It's different from a social worker per se, but an equity coordinator could start. But I think the thing that he really was trying to express, that people need to have an honest conversation about race, and that it's not all the others. It's not, I think, I don't know, what comes first, the chicken or the egg, I don't know. But I think there were some not happy folk there, but it was the data, and that's what he went on.
I do want to point out that in my report from the National School Board Association, that I heard from a district who was focused on, in North Carolina, was focused on, the recruitment of African-American teachers, but they also, and how they were turning their district around, they had an equity person in place that they had just hired, and that was part of my report. So that's the second time that's come up this year.
I saw tonight there was going to be a guest speaker to talk about the school pipeline of prison. Because I really think this kind of fits into this discussion. And I do believe that, and I tell everybody, and they're anticipating the strategic plan that you're going to roll out, because I think those are the kind of things that are going to probably bubble up as far as conversation. And I know we don't have the solutions now, but based on this presentation, we're not the only county that is struggling with some of the issues that we're struggling with. It's a national thing.
If I may, thank you for allowing me to add on to your report. I know Gwen Singleton very well and worked with Mr. Singleton and his work on courageous conversation is good work. Couple of things. I think whatever we do, one thing that I tried to comment on this in my statement earlier, whatever we do moving forward together, I want to make sure that we do it in a strategic way that is not in isolation, but we're moving towards something for all of our kids, would be the first comment I would make. The second is that I am scheduling some facilitators to work with our building principals and administrators to look at our equity issues in Clark County in October. And so there will be equity experts coming in to work with our principals. I firmly believe that you have to build a movement from the bottom up, and our building principals have to be individuals who believe in equity work if it's going to then go to our teachers and staff and so forth. Part of that equity work obviously starts with looking at the data for all kids in Clark County. And I guess the last two things I would say, it goes to what Mr. Davis talked about, and that is ultimately, however you budget a school system, it's got to reflect your values and what you believe is important for children. And so the conversations around what positions we have in the school system should emerge from our strategic plan and what we value for young people. And I think you made the statement about cookie cutter. And one thing that we have to pay attention to, especially in a district like Clark County, and it's difficult conversations, that's why you have to have a strategic plan, that is, every school is not created equal. And as we look at the data of some of our schools, we may see, if you're really committed to equity, you may see that certain schools may need more resources than others.
Yes.
But typically what we do in school systems across country that we say, well, this is the dollar amount that every school receives. And now you try to educate a population of children who may need more. And so those are some of the conversations around equity. Now, I think so many people are talking about equity nationally, but to do it well requires deeper conversation. And so I appreciate your report. It's something that is really on the forefront of what I want to work on and around. But I also understand that these are very difficult conversations that will require us to be strategic about bringing people to the table to share their thoughts and frankly to share some of their concerns and fears of just having a conversation, let alone getting to a solution. So it's going to be a long road, but I'm glad to hear that this is something that's been percolating, if you will, percolating with the CCSD Board of Education.
I don't know if the participants were prepared for that discussion, because you can't have that discussion in a day long. So I don't know how they left there, because there was some grumbling. But I think putting it out there at least, you know, opens the door. And I think the topics were a little scary, you know. I'd be a little scared if I walked, you know, I wouldn't feel that comfortable knowing that one of the topics is white privilege. I really would not be that comfortable. But he put it out there, they did it, and based on his book and his research, it's being done in a lot of places. So I'm glad that you're moving forward, at least having these same thoughts.
I connected with Glenn. He has a, if you will, for lack of a better term, support group for superintendents who engage in this work around equity, because it is, everyone isn't as fortunate as I am in working in a progressive, open-minded community like Athens Clark County.
That's right.
And so some superintendents find themselves in communities where this is difficult work and difficult conversations are conducted. And it ranges from some of the items I just mentioned to you, from allocation for each budget for a school, in terms of it can range to where do children go to school, and how do you distribute children, and what attendance zones do you create, and do you purposely create diversity in schools, and what's the impact of after school programming. It is really, it's some school systems, when they're strategic, they will hone in on equity. And when you start talking about equity, it drills down to, you may have children who graduate, but what type of graduation experience did they have? Because there's some children who will graduate, they would have taken multiple AP courses, and it's a different experience versus others. And so when you talk about equity, sometimes children can walk into the same schoolhouse, but they can have a very different school experience. And so if you're really about equity, are you providing access to every single child? We've been having, it's nice to be the new person in a school system, because you get to ask questions. And so one of the questions that I've just kind of started to ask people is, are we providing access to every child in this school system to eventually know what type of path they can have post-secondary? I would assume in Athens, we want to make sure that every child at least knows what opportunity is available to them. But you can only have that if you know what you've done on the SAT. But do we know if every child in Clark County graduates with at least an SAT experience? Or do we have children who come through our school system and will never sit for the SAT? I'm not suggesting that you have to go to a college after you take it. These are the types of conversations. This thing, we're just hitting the tip of the iceberg here. Those are the types of conversations that you want to engage around if you're going to talk about equity. Hence, what Mr. Singleton started to probe with school board members, which is, this is hard work. And in some cases, if you really get dedicated to it, it should be your sole focus. You can't jump from place to place if you're going to be truly committed to equity. The equity piece even drills down to policy. And what do you want your policy to say? So it's, as you can tell, thank you for bringing it up. I get a little fired up on that.
That's okay.
I think it's important, but it's hard work.
And that's kind of what was my takeaway, and I struggled even typing this up because I'm like, is this going to be too deep for us? But he said, and I'll just repeat what he said. So, but I'm glad that you are familiar with Mr. Singleton. Maybe we'll all get an opportunity to meet him.
Can I just piggyback on that just a little bit? One conversation that we've had, it feels like for a couple of years now, some equity in our programming at the elementary level and all the different elementary schools, and the difference in every school is fantastic, and there's a lot to embrace about that. There are certainly schools that have more resources due to more parental involvement, more location, being able to sell parking spaces or whatever, you know, and it's, and I would, and I've brought it up a few times, maybe not publicly, but certainly with our leaders about the way to equitably share some resources, that some opportunities are given to some buildings that are not given to others. And our ASP program is a really great example. Some of our schools have it, and I think all of our schools need it. And so, anyway, we can also have that conversation.
Yes.
At the high school, but.
I want to make a comment. Judge of what you said, is that it's, Sarah, first of all, I want to remind each of you, now, all of our schools have one school, they want to. And I do recall several years ago, I don't know what exactly, years, we had some inequities way Title I funds were being distributed. And you corrected that. And I'm hoping that it's still corrected the way we did several years ago. But that's something that we have to be mindful of. All of our schools are Title I schools. And just listening to some of the conversations tonight, yes, every school you go in, you're going to have a different personality in that school. Every one of them. But I think we need to be aware of the fact that still that these Title I funds are being distributed equally. Okay, Dr. Simmons.
I wanted to kind of make a suggestion, and this is not a form of a amendment or, in the vote, but I would suggest that maybe around this book, maybe Dr. Mean does another book, I would appreciate, and I don't know how you do that, I guess you have to do it in a public setting because I'm talking about school board members, but I could see a study, a series of study sessions around some reading on the issue of equity. And I would really enjoy that as collectively, and you know, the public's probably one because it's gonna be, we're gonna be all there, so we're gonna have to open it up to the public. But having that discussion, I think would be, I remember we did some of that around Connecticut schools, when Dr. Lanou was hired. But I don't know if the board was involved, because I wasn't involved in the board. And I know there was some building discussion groups that were formed. So anyway, that's just a suggestion that I offer to fellow board members that we can have a book study on the issue of that.
Thank you. Government Relations Committee.
Oh, okay. Government, that's also, I said, and it's really brief, really brief. Last month, we, Greg introduced, but we never talked about federal funding for our schools. We've never talked about that as a school board. We usually discuss our local relationships with our delegation and state. But a lot of our funds do come from the federal government, and it's filtered through our Department of Education and even our legislature. And Greg has been in contact with Johnny Eikerson's staff, staff, and who is
it?
Jody Heinz. And next month, we have been trying to plan a meeting with their staffers to talk about federal funds
and letting them know more about the needs and the challenges we face here in Clark County. I think that one of the things that shocked, well, I guess was at our meeting, when Ms. Hamel talked about 21st Century may be, is one of the funds that are looking to be cut by this administration. Well, 21st Century funds a large part of the scholarships for our kids that go to Boys and Girls Club. And so a lot of people don't know that. And so if those funds get cut, where and how do these kids take advantage of the Boys and Girls Club? So there's some things that we don't connect to the federal government, but it directly impacts. So Greg has taken it on himself to contact the staffers and have a conversation about federal funds and the needs. So we'll wait, and we have a tentative date, but we got some questions about.
I've cleared it with everybody.
Okay, so the date is?
The 22nd, Dr. Meehan said it would be available. And then we have a
reception
here, so we can be here a few minutes, and then we can retire.
Okay, so it's August 22nd at
4:30.
And so we do have the confirmation from Johnny Hankison and
Johnny so far, and I'm going back and forth with the new staff and Representative Heiss.
Okay.
Where his staff is.
Okay. See, that happens since we talked. The other thing that we talked about, and Carol was looking into I always get those initials mixed up. What are they? The excellence, yada, yada, yada.
And the
Talking with them too.
Dana Rickman from the Georgia Partnership has spoken to this board before, and I spoke with her yesterday, and she's willing to come back and have a conversation with education.
I think Dr. Meehan sent out the 2017 report that we discussed, if everybody got it. And those are, I think it's the top 10 education issues facing Georgia. So that will help us as we move forward developing our platform on the legislative issues that we want to address. And the last thing that we talked about is building our platform. And based on Mr. Hamel's report on the QPE formula, we do want to have that as one of our platform issues. Based on the data and information from Mr. Hamel, and that the fact that QPE has not been fully funded since George Washington.
Never.
But we're expected to be using that. So that's the report from the governmental committee. We'll send out emails reminding everybody about the August 22nd meeting, and we'll wait to hear when Dana Rickman will be with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Finance committee.
No,
any reports?
No, I have anything.
All right, very good. Policy committee.
Yeah, I'll just take this time just real quick to kind of sum up. We have a vote tonight on some B policies, and I just want to kind of sum up how we arrived where we are for the board and for the public. When Dr. Parrish came in as interim, we asked him to help us grow as a board to be prepared for our new superintendent, or maybe he offered to help us grow as a board to help us with our new superintendent. So he brought in an outside consultant, Mr. Glenn Brock, who is the Fulton County attorney, maybe somebody else's, but for sure he's Fulton County's attorney. And Mr. Brock did one session with us at the Fanning Institute. I believe all nine members were there that night, and it was good. We all left feeling like it was kind of the first time in a long time we had a cohesive board development. And Mr. Brock was going to go back and to Atlanta, and he was going to come back and meet with us a second time at that time to go over all of our B policies with the board. And that time we met at the Chamber of Commerce building, and there were seven of us in attendance. And we started a discussion about fee policies, which is how the board functions, those are board function policies. And it turned into just a really robust discussion, really, but kind of went off agenda, but we were all talking a lot about how I function as a board. So he left and said he would review our fee policies and bring back suggestions to us. So as chair of the policy committee, he sent me his suggestions, and I brought them to the policy committee. And that's how we are, how we work. The policy committee is made up of four of the board members, and the way that procedure works is that we review policy, that all board members are invited to attend the discussion. Just only policy committee members can vote on the changes made at policy. Once they are made at policy, they come before the full board to be placed for public comment for 4 weeks. And then we review all public comment, and then we vote to approve or not approve the policy after that 4 weeks, and then it becomes policy. The beauty of policy is that, and the beauty of the school board is we can bring it back through policy committee whenever we need to. And the way that we bring things through policy is governmental changes, suggestions from the public, suggestions from the superintendent, suggestions from board members. So anytime somebody has a question about policy or believes that the policy needs to be reviewed, or anytime the legislative makes changes, that's how we decide which policies we're bringing through. The reason we focused on our B policies at this time is because we were going to be working with a new superintendent, and so it was an effort to look at our policies and to make sure that we're refined as a board moving forward together with our new superintendent. So I just wanted to bring everybody up to speed with where the history of that, the ideas for the B policies changes did not come from a single member of this board. They came from an outside representative who listened to discussions with us and made recommendations based on our discussion and based on his experience with other boards and in the city.
Thank you.
Property committee.
Anything, Ms. Wayne?
We have a vote in it. We have a vote.
Thank you, Mr. Fane. That moves us on to policy discussion.
Okay, policy discussion, that's item D, and I just finished talking to you about this. Of course, these policies are actually the policies that are going out for public review for 30 days.
That's right. These will be out for comment on our website for the next 4 weeks.
Okay, so how can we do it again?
Not unless anybody has a question or there's any
questions about the ones that we discussed at the last policy committee meeting. If not, on a call for a motion to put them out there for 30 days of public review. Davis?
So that where we have that discussion, I'm going to send you that copy really nice and put it on the calendar. Some of this in a good sense, something like that, that if we fix it. That's primarily what I have, but one actual question I got, and that is on the exhibit for BC. questions. Will we put a policy in effect that have those two statements, number 6 and number 7? We were saying it's imposing accurate but not appropriate place for us. Why would we do it this way? I just think that that would be not problematic.
Yeah, okay. Well, on number 7, I can tell you that that's always a tension when we're trying to create a policy that's really just restating what already is state law. So do you restate the entire law? Do you attempt to summarize the law, recognizing that you're leaving things out? Or do you just say, it's already law, we don't need a policy? And there are pros and cons of all that. That's all that's
there are, but I think if we have to come to this policy down the road for guidance or something, and these two statements are there, I think that would be off-putting for us being able to make this decision.
Well, now, these statements are part of the policy. This would just be commentary to the policy committee to think about as a reviewing policy.
This is the attorney's note on the front sheet of every single policy that we have to come to.
Okay, yeah, we get those. So those don't get filed with the policies. So if it's not going to be there, then how do we address it?
That's our guide for our discussion. So when we discussed these at the policy committee meeting, this was new business. We used that as our guide for discussion.
Okay. If we have that ambiguity, when it was a separate policy.
But we went through the policy committee meeting, and I don't have all of it with me. I probably should have brought my notebook, but I did not walk out of the house without it. And I don't know if you remember, but we probably very carefully just flipped it back and forth to make sure that any of them that we were talking about were sending were to include in this new BC, that we were careful about the language that was in. But I don't remember exactly what the EDG was.
And I don't remember either, but I mean, often the policy committee does make some changes based on these comments, so that what's recommended to the board may not be what existed at the policy.
It could have been. I'd have to go back and look at the minutes. And so, or look at my notes that I mean right on. But what we can do, this is placed out for full. This is just on the table, Linda, for out for public review for the next 4 weeks. We're not voting to formalize.
Yeah, I was going to say.
If there's mild or major corrections that need to be made, that can be done.
So then I'll just go on and do my comments.
You can do that way, or you can email them to me like we did in the past.
So what if we're going to have a chance to review them so we don't have to have this conversation?
So that is like the eventual discussion or not?
That's just this is the cover page.
That's what I thought.
I mean, it's on every single policy that we ever have discussed.
And I thought it was after the district policy. I didn't understand what about the policy.
It's just the attorney's notes as to why we are in talking, why it's even there, and if he sees any legal or, you know, anything that we should consider.
I've just never seen that language in any of them.
And board members, do keep in mind this policy that we're talking about now, BC.
Yeah.
That's a new policy altogether.
But all it is a conglomerate of BCA, CBCA, BBC, or BDG, BCBK, and BCB, because instead of having all these separate policies, we decided to put it under one board meetings so that anybody who was looking for how we conduct our board meetings would go to one policy instead of having to go to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Different policies. It was an effort to be more succinct and to clean up our manual. But it's not new information. It's just a combination of information.
I'm sure the committee addressed all of this in this discussion and probably made some adjustments as before. And that's something we can look back at our notes during this 3 minutes.
Yeah, I'll make sure that BDG, you know, that number 6, and everybody should go back and just look at BDG, look at that attorney's note. But if I remember correctly, from our policy committee meeting that day, there was some confusion about new business and old business anyway. And or you didn't feel like you had prepared that new business side of it, and that was what that discussion was about.
Okay.
So you may want to just go back and relook at the new business from our last policy.
And again, these policies listed under E, policy discussion. Let me remind you again, now, these policies are going out for 30 days for the public review. And of course, board members, you also have a right to make comments about these policies and suggestions in terms of what you would want to see go in those policies. Are we all clear on that? Okay, so I have a motion to put these policies out for, okay, moved by Dr. Knox, we got a second on it, second by Ms. Byder. All in favor, so raise your right hand, please. That unanimous vote, yes, it is, motion passed. Now we're down to action items, minutes of the previous meetings. You had a work session June the 1st, you had a regular meeting June the 8th, you had a call meeting June the 26th. I'm quite sure you've read 2 minutes in the packet. I have a motion.
May I make a correction?
And your motion first, moved by Mr. Payne, second by Ms. Davis. Okay, now, questions? Dr. Knox?
Yes. Page 7 of the June 8th minutes, there's just a minor typo. It says the Lisa Shard Services contract. I think we want shared and not shard. We don't want shards in our governance. It's in the title of the bottom.
So it's a title. Got that, Ms. Weaver?
Yeah.
Thank you. Any further questions? Comments? All in favor? Thank you very much.
Mr. Worthy, it moves us to policies to adopt. This is, we're still in the action item section.
Yes.
At the work session, the board decided to take each one of these policies separately. And so the first policy up for potential adoption is policy GAD, professional.
With its regs, that means it's the board's on that. So it would be GAD plus reg 1 and reg 2.
Thank you. Thank you very much for reg 1 and 2.
Okay, all right. You've heard the superintendent's recommendation, and we did decide to vote on each one of these policies separately because there's been so much controversy about them. So we're looking at policy GAD, we look at regulation GAD, and also whether GADR1 and GADR2. Those we're talking about rescinding, those regulations, and then, of course, policy GAD revising. Now, I need a motion for approval. By Mr. Payne, got a second on that? Okay, second by Ms. Ellis. Now, questions, discussions on policy GAD. That's on professional learning opportunities. Questions? Hearing none, all in favor of this policy? Okay, all righty. Motion passed.
That moves us to the next policy, sir, which is policy JCDA, Student Code of Conduct. This one was revised.
All right, Student Code of Conduct. Moved by Mr. Davis, and a second on that, second by Mr. Bobby. Questions? We've had a ton of questions on this one already, so.
And just so everybody's clear, this is not revising the code of conduct itself. This is the policy.
Overarching. That's correct. Thank you, Mr. Attorney. Questions on that? All in favor? Thank you very much.
That moves us to policy BA, goals and objectives.
Policy BA, goals and objectives. Okay. Need a motion on that? By Mr. Payne, got a second on that. Second by Ms. Williams. Any questions about policy BA? That's on goals and objectives. Any questions on that?
This question, this is going to be for correct?
Yes. Any further questions? All in favor? Thank you very much. Motion passed. Okay.
Policy BBA. Board officers.
Okay, policy BBA, board officers. Okay, any motion on that? Moved by Mr. Biden. Got a second on that? Second by Mr. Davis. Questions? Go ahead, Ms. Davis.
It also includes the regulation.
Yes.
Which is the nomination ballot for officer elections.
Yeah, I was going to get to that. My policy BBA is a 20 minutes.
Well, policy BBA essentially introduces term limits for officers. And my concern is that I don't know if that best serves the interests of our students in terms of continuity of leadership, especially our community. Anytime we have that kind of term limit. So I would rather a term limits policy be initiated so we can address that for all offices that board members are serving. And I think, again, I find it unnecessary because every year we have new elections and we have an opportunity to elect the person that we think will best serve our community as our leader. And to deny and incumbent that opportunity, it seems that we're not giving you the opportunity to exercise one of the choose. So I feel like that whole section on term limitations should be removed.
Okay, any further questions? Any further questions? I have a comment on this question here. At the last policy committee meeting, Mr. Davis, you asked that the last sentence be struck from this policy. And I see that it's taking place. But my concern is here that since we removed that sentence from this policy, should it go back out for public review, because it's a change in that policy before we vote on. Should we go back out for public review?
It was updated right there at the table on Don and Angela updated it right there while we're sitting there on the website.
I know that, but I said it hadn't been out for public review again.
It was on, you know, on the website for public review. It was updated right there, but I think that would just be a question for our attorney.
I don't see a reason because it doesn't change it was restating the same thing that was in the sentence before. So, you know, we basically said one thing and then we restated it again. And I thought that was confusing, so that's why I proposed striking the second bit of repetition of what was being said.
And that's why I'm saying I think that should go back out for public review. But anyway, I will turn it.
Yes, sir. Keep in mind that this public comment here is not mandated by state law. It's purely a matter of board policy. The spirit of policy, obviously, is to give the public a fair chance to comment before you vote. Minor revisions are certainly part of that process. You don't put out the policy again for every little letter or thing that might be changed. At some point, sure, theoretically, changes could become significant enough that in the spirit of the policy, they should be put back out for additional comment because now it's become something entirely different than public comment on the board. I mean, I can't give you any more firm guidance to that.
Okay, any further questions on that?
I did have a question for Ms. Davis. Did I correctly understand you say that there were other officers that could also be under term limits?
I think we have people on the board that have been appointed to several of our community agencies and board representatives. We haven't addressed term limits on that either. And so I would like for us to address term limits and its own implication or effectiveness to be fair, and I think to the mind was fair to not penalize the current officers in this on our board right now. If we aren't going to get rid of this whole thing about term limits for the president and vice president, then I would like to see this policy have an effect day of 2020.
Comments on that? Go ahead, Ms. Manning.
To the board and to everyone. District Director.
mid-school system, they can have children with board and officers with board that serve for many years because of their teacher, because of their ability to lead the board and do what is best for children. I think that's what we need to keep in mind. Those individuals have to best lead the board and do the best for children. But this is why I'm here.
Mr. Turner, I'd like for you to say that last statement again in terms of something's changing in the policy. But it should go back out for the review.
Well, and I know I'm not giving the firm answer, that's because it's not one. But again, it's local policy, it's not state law. It's the spirit of the policy is to give the public a fair chance to comment before you adopt something. If you're making, so long as you're within the confines of what the public's already seen, you know, I think you're within the spirit of the policy. If those changes accumulate so much that they turn into something entirely different, then probably the spirit of the policy suggests you do that in your comments, because the public might care to say we haven't seen that. Where is that law across? That's in the discretion of the court.
And that's exactly what I understand the public. In my opinion, they have not seen this. And of course, this is others, and we would not elect officers again for this board until December. So what is the urgency?
I can speak to that.
Go ahead.
I think that this has created tension among board members. And I think that sooner it's resolved, we move on as a board, move on together as a board. I think it would be a whole lot healthier if we just let this stew. And so I'm asking that this policy come on board.
Okay, any further questions or comments on policy BB8, board officers?
Yes, is there a process by which this policy can be amended to include my suggestion on February 2020? Is that appropriate tonight, or does that feel like committed to be considered to have a paper pay?
If we voted on it tonight and people hear it and it gets turned down, then don't go back and we'll read about it. If people agree with myself tonight,
yeah.
Wait a minute, I'm trying to understand. You said that if it passes tonight, or according to you saying, if you want to amend it, goes back to policy again for amendment.
That's what I'm understanding. If we vote on this policy as written tonight, then I can suggest to go back to policy for amendment to have an effective date.
You can, or if it's not passed tonight, then it'll go back to policy for further revisions, and your suggestion will be part of the discussion then as well. But like I said in the policy committee before, when I said the policy committee reviews policies based on state legislative recommendations from superintendent, board member, public, any of it. So if you want us to pull it back through, Linda, whether it passes tonight or doesn't pass tonight, then that would be a suggestion, and we can pull it back through. That's the way we've operated and continue to operate, is anytime somebody has a policy, we pull it back through, whether it's something we just changed 1 month ago or whether it hasn't been looked at for 20 years, we pull it through. So whether it passes tonight or not, we'd like to put it back on the agenda. That is something we can absolutely do.
Bear in mind that all members, of course, if there's a motion pending on the floor, any member can make a substitute motion that has to be voted. If it's a second, then it will be voted on first. So just listening to Ms. Davis's comments, you could make a substitute motion either to implement, to have this delayed effective date for vote tonight, or you can make a substitute motion and send it back to policy committee for the committee to consider the later date.
Could I ask for clarification? Because this is about policy and we have this kind of standing rule of having the 30-day public comment, if we have an amendment like that, like a substitute motion that is different than what went out, then how does that work then? Does that then kick it back to policy?
I think it's exactly back to what I said before. If that's supposed to be motion, it's
right.
Implementing something that's so different than without right. the public comment before, then it probably is without public comment.
Okay. That's what I thought. It's a little different than usual, procedure because of the 3-day.
Okay, now I have a motion. Do you want to make a substitute motion, make an amendment to the motion, Ms. Davis?
Yes.
Go right ahead, state it.
I would like to amend the motion for policy of the VA to update to
the effective date of 2020. Okay, you got one vote tonight, I want to see
it. I would like the effective date for policy of the VA as recommended to have an effective date of 2020.
Now, amendment to the motion, as Ms. Davis stated, she would like to amend this policy of VBA that it will become effective year 2020. Now, heard that, all in favor of the second on that, I'm sorry. I'm going to give it my second. I second. And as president, I can do that. I second that motion. Okay. Now, any questions about it?
Yes. Okay. When in 2020?
January 1.
Hold on a second.
We make these elections in January.
We make them in December.
We actually do them in December. That's why I said hold on. We do them in December so that the officers can take LC in January. We stand to do it in the
work session. Do it in the work session.
It's January 2020.
Okay, it's January 2020. January 2020. Any further questions on that? All in favor of that amendment? Sure, with the right hand, please. Motion failed. Now, back to the original motion. Okay. The original motion is policy BBA. All in favor of our policy, our BBA.
And the
we didn't discuss the reg. I thought we were going to be one of them separately.
We've been doing the policies and the reg. It's just the out.
Well, if you don't have any questions.
We did that on GAD, the policy and the two regs. And then at our work session, we discussed working on policy and reg.
All right, so policy BBA, and we got regulations on policy BBA R1, which is a nomination ballot for board officers election, and that we reviewed that. Okay. Now, again, all in favor of policy BBA, let me know by showing up your right hand. Okay, all opposed?
That moves us on to policy BBBB, new member orientation.
All right. And that policy was just reviewed. We made some changes in that earlier, okay? We just reviewed that policy. Didn't have any changes in it. We need a motion on that. Moved by Mr. Payne. Got a second on that. Second by Ms. Ellis. Any questions about the two new policies? 4Bs. Any questions? Go ahead.
Just need one clarification. There is a strike for a year, so there will be a change in the revise another review. It's just an error on our agenda. Yeah. I believe not an error on our votes. It's just
a decision. You know, it does say on the cover sheet it says.
What should you have
said? It's a revise instead of review.
Okay, all right. What about the mission? That's the problems. 4Bs, okay, all right. Did I get a motion on that?
Yes,
uh-huh. And second on that question, okay, all right. So call for the vote on the policy, the 4Bs there, that was new member orientation. Okay, all in favor of that? Opposed?
That moves us to policy BBBC. And that is board member development opportunities. Board member development.
That was correct. Okay. That follows to that policy went on for review too. That's the else. Should that be revised or see, I'm looking at you.
That's review. That was correct.
Okay, that's the one promise. Okay, so that's board member compensation expenses. Okay, we reviewed that. So.
Yes.
All right, we have a motion on that.
Yes.
By Mr. Payne, I got a second on that. All right, second by Ms. Ellis. Do we have any questions about policy BBC? C, I'm sorry. That's on board members development. Questions on that? That's
just a question that we know you're talking about. We put this policy out there. What are we addressing? We want to pull opportunities. Is there some place that we have something that tells us what the process would be for everybody that go to NSBA and vote?
Personally like seeing it in finance and budget, and we also vote every annual what conferences everybody wants to go to. Like, I don't attend.
And all of that's based on tradition. And so again.
But there's also a budget. I believe the place for that discussion is in finance and in budget.
Since Linda's opened the door, I'm going to kind of restate, I think everybody's heard this before. I really, and I think Charles will back me up, and I know he will, and so will Vernon. Board members going to the National School Board Association meeting is a conference. It's like eye-opening. It's like going from the farm to the city the first time or the second time. And, you know, I would be happy to do away with the food reimbursement, you know. I mean, you know, whatever we can do, or I pay some of the way. But, I mean, the fact is that I think it's something that I would love to. I know not every school board member can go. They got family commitments, work commitments. But I really want to make sure that in terms of board development, that every board member is encouraged to attend each year. And if the people in the community that thinks that's extravagant, I will be glad to roll out my notes and have that discussion.
Number four says any other activities as approved by the board, and I can't ever remember a time when anybody wanted to attend. I've only been on the board 6.5 years, but I can't ever remember a time when somebody wanted to attend something that was, you know, beneficial to their development as a board member. Anytime anybody comes with a conference or anything they want to attend. And so I think we've been really supportive as a board of our members of attending such conferences. And I agree with you, Greg. I think it's awesome to be able to go to NSBA, and I would hesitate to put a dollar limit in policy when the budget changes annually so much depending on tax digest. And so there may be years that it may, because we have a budget, may have to really look hard at cutting that, or maybe yours are a little fatter, we can add to it. So if we limit it in policy, we're going to be changing that policy all the time, spending time on it. But if it's tied back to the budget and it's an allowable item in the budget, I think that's a cleaner and easier annual way to evaluate that number versus annually evaluating it.
And you're exactly correct, guys. The $2,000 Pam just mentioned, you have to keep in mind that we don't use all of that money to go to ENSBA. We use that money for training sessions, etc. Because when you look at a national conference, you know, look at $2,000, it's not that much, because you have to pay $700 registration fee. Okay? And when you go, of course, you've got to be reimbursed for your food. But I'm not eating that McDonald's or that dinner anyway, that's I'm going to eat at a decent place. And the amount of money that is allowed by the state, then of course if you go over that amount, you know, as a board member, you know that you're going to have to pay for that yourself. And then of course you got transportation in there. So all those things must be considered. You know, so $2,000 is not that much. But you know, as board members, we are here responsible for spending taxpayers' money like anyone else. Okay. Any further discussion on what is...
Thank you for all the clarifications. Again, I just want us to be conscious of the policies that we put out that we can and cannot support. I really do think about that financial aspect needs to be added to the policy. We know that it is a budget expense.
Okay, any further discussion?
I just want to make one more clarification.
Sure.
It's a revise as well, not a review. That's just a mistake on our agenda.
Yeah, because I see all of these on I'm satisfied. Okay, any further questions on this? If not, all in favor?
And this policy, Mr. Worthy and board members, is BBBE, Board Member Compensation and Expenses.
BBBE. Need a motion on that policy? Moved by Ms. Williams. Second by Ms. Davis. Any questions on the policy BBE? Any questions? conversation on that page. Any questions on that? Hearing none, all in favor?
The next policy is BBC, Board Committees.
Okay. The motion on that, that's on Board Committees. And that's in the back, okay? Moved by Mr. Davis, and second on that. Second by Mr. Bible. Questions? Questions? There are times, questions. Hearing none, all in favor of that policy, show your right hand, please. Okay. All opposed? Motion passed.
The next policy is BBE, School Attorney.
All right. Need a motion on that? By Mr. Payne. Got a second from you, Ms. Davis? Ms. Davis?
No.
Second?
I have a question.
Okay. All right. Go ahead, question.
So my question, I'll get you to put that open statement. Now, in two sentences there, what you're saying, you feel the council to allow the advice on the matter of the president of the authorities. So we think that attorney should be filling out.
Oh. I would not attend if the attorney's not here.
Or if the council shall be present at all of the meetings.
Yes.
Yeah.
You think there's a right on that?
What now?
So shall we do it?
Okay, hold on.
I would say that's a grammatical change that we can make here on the fly.
Well, let's talk about this. That says change or shall, which means must.
Yes.
Okay? And you stand to be present, okay?
Oh, I see. It could be either way.
Yeah.
So do you have a matter?
That works. I live with that. Say that again so that we can hear you.
Council.
All right. Please with that. Any further questions?
What do we do? I'm sorry.
For appear after matters, Mr. Davis. Said council shall be present. Okay. All in favor? Thank you very much. Motion passed.
That moves us to the next policy, which is BBF, Advisory Committees.
All right. BBF, I need a motion on that. Yeah, but I need a motion. Moved by Ms. Davis. Second by you, Ms. Williams. Okay. Any questions on advisors of the committees? That's what we need to consider that policy. Any questions? Ms. Stiles, I read this earlier. Can you talk to the board in terms of why did we send this policy?
I'm not sure about that. We combined it with board committees.
Combining the board committees?
Yes.
I just need you to draw a number there. Yeah, okay, all right.
And again, this was an effort to just, you know, review the policy.
Okay, all right. All right, any further questions on that? All in favor? Motion passed. Okay.
Next policy and the last policy is BBFA and the corresponding regulation of BBFA hyphen R paren.
Okay. All right. Any motion on that? By Mr. Davis, second by Mr. Payne. Any questions on that? I think we know why we were sending that policy.
We are waiting on our new policy coming next month for LSGTs.
Yeah.
To replace the books.
We're sending that policy because school councils are out, local school governors are team team. Okay?
And maybe we keep it that way even if we elect a new governor.
I don't know about that. Any further questions? All in favor? Thank you very much. Motion passed. All right.
That moves us to the consent agenda on board members, and it's, that moves us from consent agenda item number 3, which is the out-of-state field trips, and it goes all the way through appointment of the ADA 504.
Okay, recommendation from the superintendent on the consent agenda, moved by Mr. Manning, seconded by Ms. Davis. All in favor? Motion passed.
That moves us to the next agenda item, which is increase in the charter expenditure limits for House Bill 556. It's our recommendation that the expenditure limit be increased.
Okay, we talked about this forever. Okay, that's item 21, recommendation on increased charter expenditure limit per House Bill 556. Any motion on that?
If I may, Mr. Worthy.
I'm sorry.
No, I apologize. If board members will notice in the executive summary, there's an outline of current policy, current procedure, and the recommendation. As we discussed in our session last week, any purchases between $10,000 and $79,999 will continue to be monitored and provided on a monthly basis to the board for your oversight. But the purpose of this recommendation is to allow this Board of Education to use its time to focus on some of the things that we discussed earlier on the front end of the meeting, equity within our school system and improving student performance. So that's the logic for the recommendation.
Thank you, Dr. Means, for your beautiful explanation. Moved by Ms. Crane, got a second on that, second by Ms. Davis. Any questions about item 21? Ms. Increase. All in favor? Thank you very much. Okay. Item 23.
22.
I'm sorry, 22.
Item 22, yes, sir. I did not, and I would be remiss if I didn't say this before the end of this evening, but this is my first official court meeting in the Clark County School District, so I'm very, very pleased to be here and with all of you in an official role. But prior to me being here, I sat in that audience for a few meetings and saw a very skilled, a very dedicated educator to the superintendency as a trade and vocation, but also to the state of Georgia, and that is Mr. Dr. Jack Parrish. He served this school district well as the interim, and part of his ongoing service to the Clark County School District is that he is serving as a transition consultant to the school system, and I know the board and I are very pleased that he is willing to continue to assist us. And so this evening, board members, I am recommending that you approve and make official the consulting contract for Dr. Jack Parrish.
Okay, you heard the recommendation. Okay, approved by Mr. Payne. Got a second from you, Ms. Davis. Okay, any questions on this? Item 22. Any questions? All in favor? Motion passed. Last item
is personnel. This is a service-oriented business, and you need people to work with the young people. I want to thank our building principals and the Human Resources Office for continuing to find and to fill roles. What's in front of you this evening are the assignments for the newly hired, hopefully hired upon your approval, personnel that will be working with our children.
Okay. Superintendent recommendations on personnel. Okay, any motion on that? Moved by Dr. Knox. Got a second on that? Second by Mr. Payne. I don't see any person. All in favor? Motion passed. Okay. All right. Motion for adjournment. Moved by Mr. Davis. Second by Mr. Payne. All in favor?
Before we adjourn, I'd like to thank you, Mr. Worthy, and the Dallas for your service to our board as president. Enjoy the rest of your transition time.
You're perfectly right. Okay. All right. Good.
I think it was probably unanimous.